hear from Kevin Bolling, who is the executive director of the Secular Student Alliance, and he will be speaking to us about the next generation of the secular movement. Are you ready?
So, welcome. Thank you for having me here. I really appreciate it. So, it's good to be here. So I want to go over a few things today, and I thought I'd just run this down so you know a little bit what to expect. So we're going to start out, I'm going to give you a little bit of the mindset of the upcoming generation. So what are our younger people thinking? What influences have impacted them that sort of form their mindsets? We'll go over a little bit the changing world on the college campus, where we sort of exist and my work every day is. Working with the Secular Student Alliance. And that's also then sort of engaging the next generation of the secular movement. And I think a lot of things I talk about are really skills that you can look at, one with working with youth, but also working with sort of making your organizations more open and more accessible to just new members in general. And then also things that you can do to help sort of that process along. And then if we have some time, answering any specific questions that you might have as well. So happy to do that. So a little bit about the Secular Student Alliance. So we're the only national organization that's dedicated to working with atheists, humanists, and other non-theist students. So we have, we're looking at, consider us working with the future leaders of the secular movement, but we're also working with the future business, community, political leaders in our communities, and we want them to have secular values, strong secular values. So with the Secular Student Alliance, we have about 300 chapters across the United States. Most of those are in college and universities. We are in a handful of high schools, and we had our first middle school chapter start up this year. So we know it wasn't that long ago that about 1 in 5 of the population identified as non-religious. We know that's about 1 in 4 now. And for the younger generation, for students, it's about 1 in 3. So we can definitely see where that trend is going. Give a little applause in the audience. And we're very happy about that. So we have a growing number of younger people becoming non-religious. So this is just a really cute. This is me. This is Bailey. So she started the middle school chapter in Utah. So she just turned 13 about a month ago. And just to make you feel like a little bit less of an underachiever, she's on her third book. That's what I was doing when I was 13. And she's cute as a button. Had to show a little Bailey. But I want to talk about the next generation. So who are, what is this younger generation coming up? Who's going to be the next generation of the secular movement? And so Beloit College every year does an assessment. So when they look at sort of what the mindset of the incoming generation, the incoming class into college is. And so this is for 2020. So it would be the school year that's actually just ending. Many of our students just went through completed graduations. And so they're beginning their summer break. So yeah, so for class of 2022. So for them, they are their parents will share their memories about 9/11, and their grandparents will share their memories about D-Day. So since they have been born, the United States has been at war the entire time. And I actually saw a little story today where the parents who started the war in Afghanistan now have children who actually can be sent to Afghanistan to fight in that exact same war. So Donald Trump has always been a political figure, as a Democrat, as an independent, and as a Republican. Putin has always been calling the shots at the Kremlin. Bill has always been known as, is now known as Hillary's aging husband. They have no idea who Newt Gingrich is. There has never been an Enron in their world. Chernobyl has never produced any power. Cloning has always been a standard laboratory procedure. Vaccines have always been erroneously linked to autism. The abortion pill has always been available. Sandy Hook was their Columbine, and this is the first generation to have drills and to know that they can be shot in their schools. In the Forbidden City in China, you have been always able to get your cafe latte at Starbucks. Many of us probably remember the Encyclopedia Britannica on your shelves. They do not. They just simply go online and get it for free. So they've always had Survivor. Snowboarding has always been an Olympic sport. Ketchup has always come in green. They will argue with their parents about what the first episode of Star Wars is. So they probably have never heard the little dial-up or you have mail. They have lived in a completely floppy-less world. So, however, they've always had the nanny cam to check in live from anywhere in the world, wherever they want. They've been able to use their thumbprints to identify themselves. eHarmony has always been using its algorithms to identify love and happiness. So, and they really don't care about email. It's about texting, instant communication. So I'm not going to go into a lot of detail or talk about millennials, but just to get an idea of the generation. So we had baby boomers, and your millennials sort of start with generation X, Y, and Z. And I would say generation Z, we're at the end of the alphabet, last generation we have. But we're really, what we're focusing more for college age population is really generation Z. So those, you know, people who were born after 1995. But I think the reality for most of our local groups and AHA groups across the country is we're sort of looking at younger people to come into our groups and new people to come in our groups. And as I said, I'm going to share lots of ideas, but again, for students, but these are really, really anything that you can use, just making your groups more accessible to just new people in general. But a little bit about the millennials, and this is a little bit more about Gen Y. So there's about 80 million of them in the United States, about 2.5 billion worldwide. So the largest generation ever. So they're the most ethnically and racially diverse. They grew up with social media, so that's just been part of their lives. And why they matter. In 2020, they'll be 50% of the workplace. By 2030, they'll be 75% of the workplace. And they aspire to make a difference in what they do every day. They're super confident, they've got high expectations, and they are achievement-oriented. And let me tell you, we see that every day with our students. Bailey's a great example, 13, three books. So yes, they're also technoholics. So they are about five different screens. So that's a part of their world, and it's integrated into their lives. The information now, I think when social media first started, we knew we put something up and it was permanent, it was always there. And for them, it's the emphasis on temporary and private is becoming much more important. Even as Facebook's new, in their new annual reports, they change from everything to the future is private. They're getting it. So, and this is very much where this generation is. But it's also real-time connection and something that's really transformed the amount of information that they have available to them. And I think that's a great thing for our movement, the information that's available, but it's also real-time connection. They can be on a video chat instantaneously live with anyone in the world at any time. So, and that's what they're used to. And they're using that because they're super creators and they're super collaborative. And so that technology is allowing them to do things that really would be very difficult for us to do in the past, and for the future becomes much, much, much more easy. So when we're looking at it, we're talking about lots of people. Our goal, you know, what we really work with is those students and those people who really identify as atheists, or as non-theists, or as humanists, or as free thinkers. So we'll get just a little bit into that moving forward. So we know about 1 in 4 of the population, religiously unaffiliated, and again, about 1 in 3 of students are. So of that, about 19-20% atheist, agnostic, humanist, free thinker, and identifying in that way. And that's really for the Secular Student Alliance. These are the people who we really work with on an everyday basis. So we sort of asked our students, you know, how they identify in a survey that we recently did. And so you see a large percent of are identify as atheist. But for those of you who are sort of quick, you realize this does not equal 100% at all, because most of the people, most of our students, selected 3 or 4 identities. So I think the secular movement has been and has been moving away from this thing where you have to be a humanist or you have to be an atheist, or you have to be this. Our students are clearly saying, no, we don't identify as a singular feature anymore. We are identifying with multiple features. And one of the reasons why we use the term secular as an organization is we want to be an umbrella group. We want wherever the students are in their identity, and we know when they come into college and they're leaving, they're probably going to change by the time they leave. Just as they're coming in, they're coming very dualistic, and then as they move along, that's, you know, they're losing some of that identity, and they're able to see that there's different shades. And again, three or four is the most common thing that they're picking as their identifiers. We also know that students in general, and younger people in general, the labels aren't as important anymore. So them identifying as an atheist or as a humanist is less and less important to them. It's more about what you're doing, and it's about how you're changing the world. And we see that every day with the students. We'll show you a little bit more about that later. One of the things that we are also interested in is like, okay, so that's how you identify now. Like, our organizations are, you know, are we just filled with a bunch of atheists who are now still atheists? And the answer is no. So we know, like, almost 75% of our students grew up in Christian households. So, and a very small percentage grew up in non-religious or secular households, as they identified. And the other there at the bottom, that's largely people who identified as Mormon. So, for us, we know that there is a conversion process taking place in people leaving religion and coming to our organizations. And we love that we can be a place for that to happen. College happens to be a time when there's a lot of that is taking place. When you look at advertisers and companies who are trying to get into the college market to do their products, there's a reason, because they know once you get into something in that age group, it's a specific time where you're forming your own standards and your ideals, you will probably continue that with the rest of your life. So this is a crucial time for our movement and just in the world where students are identifying, and we want them to be involved. We want them to have that identity. We want them to be comfortable with that identity and explore that. So we want them to have those conversations. We also do have religious students in our organizations, and I love that we do. It's one of the few places that they can go on a college campus and have a conversation about if they have doubts about their religion, or if they want to just talk about religion in general without the confines of their own specific dogma of their religion. I love that we have that place where that students can have that focus as well. So we talk about religion. Why not talk about some politics? So for us, about 56% of atheists identify as quote-unquote liberal. And again, we know that younger generations aren't buying into those labels again. And I think when you look at what their beliefs and practices are about how they live their lives, this looks a little bit low. So about 74% support the government giving aid to the poor. Almost 90% believe that abortion should be legal. So about 95% LGBT issues, not a problem whatsoever. So 80% saying we should have stricter laws on the environment. And 83% say that the right and wrong depends on the situation. So there's no longer this higher being or institution saying, this is what you need to believe in, is what is right is wrong. They're going, no, yeah, we're really going to make that up for ourselves. And we understand that it's conditional. We understand that our values are what help create that. So this is, you can see if you look at our population and what we look at for politics, this is fairly liberal as far as what they believe. So we know about 20 years ago, about 1 in 10 of the Democratic voters were religiously unaffiliated. And right now, that's about 1 in 3. So it's about 15% for the Republican Party. So we asked our students, how do you identify? So politically. And so you can see there, we had a few students who were identified as conservative, a few in the middle, but clearly the large percentage of our students politically identify as liberal. So that just helps us to get them to know them better, what's important to them. And we find this really reflected a lot within the secular movement anyway. So the campus, where we work every single day, I'm privileged to have students who are student leaders on campuses and what they're doing, changing their communities on the local campus level and getting involved in the local community. So our students are active and involved. So one of the things that we do know is college campuses are also home to a large number of faith-based ministries. So the four largest, so Newman, Hillel, Campus Crusade for Christ, and Navigators. Anyone I have an idea about what their annual budget is combined? I know you do. $1 billion, with a B. So that's why those organizations have buildings on college campuses or adjacent to, and they have staff on, you know, at college campuses. They understand that this time period is crucial for what they are doing. So on some campuses, we know that there may be up to 120 religious organizations, student organizations, and only one secular student alliance. So we oftentimes are the only game in town for secular students, even though we see this rising number of students who are non-religious on college campuses. And we're actually going to start doing work and working with student affairs departments and going, what are you doing on your college campuses for their moral and value development? So, and we had a big sign at one of their conferences going, 1 in 3 of your students are non-religious. And most of them came up and didn't believe us. So, and we had the data there to support it. We had the Pew and PRR studies going, yep. And so then we said, what are you doing for their value development? And they had no clue. They've never thought of it before. And so those are the conversations. We're working with the students, and they're providing community, and they're doing what they can to help with the students. We also want to help change the entire college structure within the institution. So it was interesting. A few years ago, about 12 of the largest campus ministries got together, and they did this big study, because what they realized was about 70% of Christian college students ended up leaving their faith during their first year on campus. Now, you can imagine this was a little scary for them. They actually got together, sunk millions of dollars, did a nice little study, and sort of figured out what was taking place. There wasn't an exact definition of what leaving the faith was. My assumption, and sort of reading some of the material, was they stopped participating, they stopped coming to either the campus group or the church or those sorts of things. So, but their response was phenomenal. So they created Campus Link. So to rejuvenate God's presence on college campus. So they want to double the number of people on college campuses who are now typically conservative Christian. And in doing that, so they started Campus Link. So they identify students in high school, and they find out where they're going to college. And before they even leave to go to college, they're automatically sending them information on, here is the student group, here is the local building, here is the local church. Here's all this information that you have. They also realized that the first 72 hours at college was important. And that's not the 72 hours where the classes have started. That's the 72 hours from when they first set foot on the campus. They have someone meet them and take them to the student organization, or take them to the ministry, or take them to the church, whatever that is, to get them involved. Because they understand that attachment is crucially important. That building community is crucially important, because now all of a sudden you're on a brand new college campus with tens of thousands of people, and you automatically have friends, and you have this group that's going to support you. So I think that's a great thing for us to learn, and you know, with us, is people are looking for a community. And we often we're a group of non-joiners. You have people in your local groups. We're joining stuff. We need to change our own mindset and open that door so that we're welcoming people and creating that opportunity for more people to get involved. The Christian communities get it. If we do a better job, we can see great results as well. One of the other things that the campus link does is there are resources for students to go and reconvert non-religious students back to the religion. Many of you are probably familiar with Project Blitz. I'm not going to go a lot into it. I know American Atheist, FFRF, Americans United does a lot of information out to the secular community about this, keeping you up to date. But this is really one of the big areas where we see the In God We Trust posters and the Bible literacy groups, the Bible studies, and now going into college campuses where they're actually going and funding student government elections to get more religiously conservative students in the leadership roles on college campuses. Because they know the percentage of people who are a student government leader or president going on to be in politics is really high. So they're working at the ground level to make this happen. And again, millions of dollars that they are investing in their future. So, highly organized, proselytizing, and extremely well-funded. I think as a secular movement, we really need to understand that we need to be investing in our future. If we're not, let me tell you, it's very clear who is. So we need to make sure that we're doing that. So, a little bit about our students. So this is at our conference last year in Columbus, Ohio. This summer, we're here in LA at the University of Southern California. So that'll be in about a month in July. So our students, just a little bit about them, I'm getting some of the stuff that they're doing on their campus so you get a better feel for what's important to our students, but a little bit about their demographics. So we know that our leadership and our membership are fairly similar in their demographics. They're about 50% male, 50% female. We love that. They're mirroring the population, our general population. We also know that about 25% are identifying as people of color. And about 20% are identifying as lesbian, gay, or bisexual, with another 5% as trans and gender nonconforming. So the population coming, that's a picture of what the population coming up through the secular movement is. When you think about your organizations, does that mirror what they are? They want to make sure that they're seeing people like them in these national, local groups as well. So what they're involved in, clearly the separation of church and state is important to them. One of the unifying issues for all of our students, if there's one, that's the one, that's it. So that's where they all start from, but they also get it. Social issues are largely part of separation of church and state. There are secular issues. So things that are important to them, the environment, clear and easy. Environment is largely important, environmental issues. Racial justice, important to them. LGBT rights. Making sure that we have women's reproductive health is universal health care. Also that their campuses are safe places for all of their students. So immigration, we have groups working with some of the groups in the local groups in Tucson who are working with when ICE drops off immigrants coming into the country. So, and also the Dreamers. I mentioned gun rights. These are actually, we had the March on Washington for after Stoneman Douglas. And we sent 1,000 of these posters. We had multiple of our groups who actually went and marched, not only in D.C., but also in local marches within their own communities. They met up with the Humanist and Ethical Union groups. We sent about 1,000 of these posters out. So we're going, hey, look, we want policy and change. Thoughts and prayers aren't doing it anymore. One of the interesting things is we put secular values in action at the bottom of these. So we had all our people all had them, and then we had lots of extras. So we just passed them out. They were gone within 5 minutes. So what we love is there are people who probably for the first time had to sit and think on their poster, secular values. Again, these are our students. They're out there. They're living this. They're our representatives in this new world about what secular values are and how they're living their life. They have no issue or problem with this. It's part of their everyday. They're also politically motivated, which we told you about. Last year we worked with registration drives, voter registration drives on their campuses. We're hoping to do something really big in 2020 again. But they're active in this, doing voter registration, getting other students politically involved as well. They're also doing community service. So this is actually a picture. This spring break, we did our first secular spring break. We took a group of students to Puerto Rico. A year and a half ago, Hurricane Maria came ashore. We were actually in Yabucoa, the town where the hurricane came ashore, and we were building roofs, so rebuilding roofs. We were working about a dozen homes while we were there with a bunch of different people from all over the United States and really from all over the world. One of the most hardest weeks I've ever worked in my life, but absolutely fantastic. We plan on doing something like this every year. Clearly, we won't get, we'll be going to someplace else besides Puerto Rico. But the number of homes that we worked on where the roofs were still leaking, we had one family who was, for a year and a half, who's been living in their hallway because every time it rains, there's mold and stuff growing in the rest of the house. So it was phenomenal to see, and scary to see what the condition of Puerto Rico still really is there. But couldn't be more proud of our students and working with them. Interesting, the woman in the middle there, she's got the blower. She was my bunkmate. So she's 73, former PE teacher. So in the first day, she's gruff, just matter of fact. She comes over, she goes, okay, what's this with all these students? I'm like, well, Secular Student Alliance, da da da. She's like, love it. So yeah. So are you ready? So one of the things we want to do, we want to make sure that the local groups and the national organizations are connecting with students. We often hear is like, our question back to some of the groups is, why do you want young people involved? Why do you want new people involved? Often what we hear is our members are getting older and we're worried that our organizations die off. That's not a great reason on how to get new people. So if you, what you're doing and is you want to just do that same thing, you really don't want new people in your organizations. You have to look at what young people want, what new people want, and you have to be doing some change to what you're doing, getting out of your comfort zone a little bit and changing that to make things happen. Or young people and new people won't be coming in. We'll just look quickly, a little bit looking at the Secular Student Alliance, friends and family, and just sort of general youth outreach. So the Secular Student Alliance, we really look at being a part pipeline within the secular community. So one, we have a great relationship with Camp Quest. So we really, you know, looking at your youth within the secular organization, it's really these two organizations. Lots of our leaders are involved in Camp Quest as volunteers, and many of our students started out in Camp Quest and come to us. We have a great relationship. We love that that takes place. We want to be a pipeline then to the rest of the community. We're doing all of this student leadership. So one of our students has done the main stage on the Capitol steps in Sacramento for Free Thought Day. We have students who in Minnesota who is the assistant state representative for American Atheist. So we have students who are involved in almost all of these organizations on staff who used to be SSA members. We are doing a lot. We want to keep them involved. And I think one thing, if we look sort of humanistically at this, all of these organizations should be helping each other. If not, I don't know that we can really call ourselves, if we're not helping each other, I don't know if we're calling ourselves, fair to call ourselves humanists. A lot of what we're talking about is building relationships. So we want to build relationships with new people. So I think oftentimes it's a question of who from your group is the best to do that. So I have a bit of experience in the LGBT movement, civil rights movement. I've worked for a number of years. And I think like sort of the secular movement, the atheist movement, and the LGBT movement, when they first started, it was a fight. Like, it truly was a fight. And to put yourself out there was against society. So there are some people with our groups in the LGBT community, I know many who I truly respect, who are still in that fight mode. And I get it. Oftentimes, the new people, that's not the best people to have as your first ambassadors. So it's oftentimes when groups are having these conversations, how are we going to invite new people? It's also sort of identifying who are the best people to do that. Who are, your more friendly people? Who are your more open people? Who are the people that it's easier to have a conversation with? And those are just some things to look at when we're having those conversations. SSA started in 2000, and we've been growing all across the United States. We're almost in all 50 states, so we're getting much, much closer. And we do have a chapter in Puerto Rico. So reaching out to SSA students. So one thing we often hear is we keep inviting them to our events. We keep inviting them to our meeting. We keep inviting them to our things. And we hear that all the time. It's not going to work. They don't know who you are. They don't have formed a relationship with you. And so we really want to really be effective. We want to help turn that around. So it's starting to go to them. And we are here to help be a conduit with that. We're here to help to make those introductions. If you've got something you want, we are more than happy to spend time with you doing that. And we have campus organizers who work with our student leaders every day, and they can do that. But the first thing to do is oftentimes ask the student leaders how you can help them. Oftentimes, no one besides us has ever asked them that. So that's a great thing. They may not have an answer for you right away. You may have to ask more than once. And again, we're here to help with that. Ask if you can go to their meeting or their event. It's theirs. They need to have the ownership in that, and they need to be the ones that continue that. Ask if you can come to that. When you go, listen. See what's happening, taking place. You probably, will want to go. You see things that are happening, things that can be better. That's great. It's their thing. Let them be in charge. If you're asked, make a suggestion or two on maybe how it can get a little bit better. But, let's make sure we're building, being positive. Because we want to build trust. And that's, we're building relationships and how we're moving forward. And again, this is how it works with any new people coming into organizations. With our students, what we would love to see is to take that relationship even further and getting sort of this mentoring relationship. And Bart Campolo was actually at USC. What he did with the chapter, did some fantastic stuff of really deepening their relationship. If you've ever heard him talk, you understand where that comes from within him. But he really would. One of the things he looked at was helping the students plan their meetings. This isn't being at the meeting and doing that. This, he met with them ahead of time, going, okay, what are you going to talk about? Like, how are you going to do that? Do you have everything that you need? He was also, you know, with their events, doing those sort of things. In the background, allowing them to take their organizations. We have seen where all good intentions, people come in and go, oh, I'm going to help them, and they wind up taking over, and the organization devolves. Because the students then have no leadership or ownership in it. They have to have that continue. So attending their events, bringing other people, great ways to help. Again, they get a chance to know you. Sending them a little text of encouragement. Taking them out to coffee. Doing something that with that. And then when we get better, we're getting into those internships and career advice and those sorts of things. There's no magic wand. So I can't tell you, oh, if you do 1, 2, and 3, it's going to work. Every one of our chapters are different. As every one of the local chapters within HA and American Atheists and all the, they're all different based on what their regions are and those are things. So it takes a little time. But what can local organizations do to help support? So fun and active meetings and events, so highly important. So often, no problem. So fun and active meetings and events. So again, that same old discussion, changing it up, doing fun and active things. They like to be doing stuff. If you're having just a discussion, people come in, they listen to the discussion, they leave. So that's often not a great way then for you to get to know people and those things by doing something. Do a community service project, going out and cleaning up a river. Maybe not all your members could attend, but that's fine. But you get a chance to have a conversation with someone and be able to move that along. Volunteering, great way. You can see our students love to volunteer in what they're doing. Inviting them to have an active role is highly important. Again, lots of student leadership involved. And if a student comes in and say, hey, I really like to do something, if you tell them no, you'll probably never see them again. Same thing with a new person. Hey, what about this? If you tell them no, you're probably not going to see that again. So finding a way, and that's not that you have to do that particular project, but making sure they feel involved and that they're being heard is important. So a lot of the things that our local groups can do, and we have groups that who sponsor a scholarship for an SSA student. So our scholarships will actually start this summer. And we often have local groups who are doing things for our students to attend conferences and those sorts of things. So I know we're moving on. So,
yes, thank you so much, yeah. Kevin. Yeah, we want to give them a break. But no problem. Fantastic. And I'm sure, do you have an email? If they have questions,
sure. If any questions, you go to secularstudents.org. And my email is kevin.bolling@secularstudents.org.